Hi guys, so welcome back. This is Jason here from Nathaniel. In this lesson, we are basically going to explore the study of secondary dominance from a theoretical perspective and also using a masterpiece of a song called Do Re Mi from the movie The Sound of Music. So what is really great about this melody is that every landing note of the melody line, and by landing note I mean the long notes or the notes which are at the one of the bar, you have to notice that all of those are chord tones, okay? And in some cases, a lot about this song has chords which are outside the key. In this case, the key of the song is B flat. And I've covered the melody and the chords in the previous part. So if you haven't already, do head over and check out that part if you don't know the melody to Do Re Mi from The Sound of Music, right? If you do, just stick around. Even if you don't know the melody, it's fine. This is just to show you the chord movement of the song, okay? So the song is on the key of B flat. Now you have a bunch of chords, right? You have your seven available triads, which are B flat major, C minor, D minor, E flat major, F major, G minor, A diminished, and of course you repeat that tonic chord. You don't have to repeat it, it's just there. So the major chords are 1, 4, and 5. The minor chords are 2, C minor, 3, D minor, 6, the G minor, and you have the lone diminished chord, which you rarely use in any case. Now, this song uses these chords for sure, as most songs in the key will. They will stick to the diatonic harmony, but it also uses a lot of chords which are outside the scale, okay? And this is governed by a topic of music called as secondary dominance, okay? And secondary dominance come after something else called primary dominance. So first, let's look at that. In a major scale, like B flat, if you go up the fifth, it will be B flat, C, D, E flat, F. If you go to the F, the fifth, you play the major chord on the fifth. What happens is this chord seems to want to and really magnetically attracts towards the tonic or the root chord. F wants to go to B flat. That's because of those semitones between the A and the B flat. And if you couple it with the E flat, right, which makes it an F dominant seventh. So there are two attractive things going on. There's E, B flat, and then there's E flat, D. Flat D, okay, right? So the F seventh chord, or just a plain and simple F major, its job, or somehow it just feels like it with the laws of musical physics, to resolve to the tonic chord, which in this case is B flat major, because we are in the key of B flat major, okay. So that's about the primary dominant. Find a scale, get its fifth. Fifth goes to one always. Now, you also have something called as the secondary dominance. Secondary dominance are chords which are still fifths of other chords of the scale. Okay, so it'll not be the fifth of the home chord, which is B flat. It'll be fifth of the two, or fifth of the three chord, or fifth of the four chord, fifth of the five chord, fifth of the sixth chord, or maybe even the fifth of the seventh chord. But the problem is, if you do fifth of the seventh chord, you're resolving to a diminished chord. So you're going from something unstable to something even more unstable. So the fifth of the seventh is generally ignored, at least in theory, it is actually ignored. So remember, you have the fifth of the two chord, which is the two minor, fifth of the three, which is the three minor, fifth of the four, which is the four major, fifth of the five, which is the five major, and fifth of the six, which is the six minor, or the relative minor in the key of whichever major scale. Okay, so you go B flat, which is the one. Now, C minor is the second. Now, naturally, C minor feels like it's left the house, so to speak. B flat feels home, but C is like away from home, you know? It's like you've started your journey. But if you do a chord which pulls back to C minor, it'll make C minor itself sound stable, because within that vicinity of chords, C minor is way more stable than the chord which is anchoring or resolving towards it. So how do I get the secondary dominant chord of C? You go a fifth or a perfect fifth. It's good to know your intervals. So you just skip immediately. The circle of fifths is also great for this exercise. In fact, we've done a really nice lesson long, long ago on circle of fifths using what's called as dominant resolution. It'll be in the description. Do check it out. So let's look at the 2 minor again of B flat, which is C minor. Its fifth is G. So you do G major or G dominant 7th. G, B, D, F. Right? And then it resolves to the 2 minor. Remember, the 2 minor of B flat major is C minor. So its fifth is G. Resolves to C minor. So the primary dominant F7th resolves to B flat. Resolves to B flat. And then G7th resolves to C minor. Okay, now we want to find the chord which resolves to the 3 minor, which is D minor. Okay, again you calculate upper fifth. D's perfect fifth is A. So you do A7, da da da, D, D minor. Okay, A, D. So A7th becomes the secondary dominant of D minor. And to name it, you just say 5 of 3 or 3 minor. 5 of 3 minor. So far, what do we have? The normal primary dominant, F7th, B flat. Okay, resolving to the tonic. And then you do 5 of 2. Okay. That's G7th going to C minor. And then you have A7th going to D minor. Okay. Now what's the 4? The 4 chord is E flat major. What is its fifth? It's B flat. Okay. So. Na, do, 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 do. That's B flat dominant 7th going to E flat. Okay, B flat, E flat, B flat, E flat, right? It's also called, in church music, we call this the plagal cadence or the amen cadence, which is usually done at the end of a hymn. So you go, so where did I resolve to the 4? Even though habitually the 4 is like not a normal stable chord when you're composing songs in major, but this is a beautiful concept because it allows you to kind of have another home, a secondary home. So again, where have we come from so far? B flat primary dominant, F7th, F7th going to B flat, G7th going to C minor, A7th going to D minor. Okay. So train your ear by singing the roots of the chords or anything to connect those two chords. Whenever you use a secondary dominant, you need to use it in combination with the resolving diatonic chord. Otherwise, I don't think it makes real sense. It'll just be like jumping away and for no reason, you know, and you don't have a pathway to come back, you know. So you need to practice that, those two chord sets or that cadence, to kind of let your ear decide how you're going to connect even melodically between chord to chord. So da 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 da. And then we have to go to E flat. Da 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 da. That's your E flat. Da 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 do 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 do. Okay. So that's resolving to the 4. So that's your 5 of 4. And now what's my 5? F major. So what's the 5 of 5? Right? It's a funny name, but you have to deal with that. 5 of 5, F's fifth, FC. So you'll go C7th, F. These are all 7th chords. 7th chords will pull really well to that landing. So da da, that's C7 going to F. Okay. And let's move forward. What's the 6 now? G minor. 6 is always minor. What is G's fifth? D. This is actually not the right way to count it. I'm just showing you for visualization, but you need to just know that G's fifth is D. You have to. And study the circle of fifths. It's really helpful. There will be a circle of fifths playlist in our description. I've done a lot of videos on the circle of fifths where I've really stressed on the fact that the circle of fifths is actually even more important than learning scales. You should probably do that as much or more as how we tend to remember and get used to our scales. So what's the circle of fifths playlist? Okay, so you go, where am I now? I'm on the five. Oh, sorry, I was on the six. So what's the five of six? That'll be D seventh and G minor. Okay, D seven, G minor. And remember, we avoid the five of seven because seven is diminished. Let's go through all the secondary dominants, and then very shortly we are going to see how it's used in the great masterpiece of a song called Do Re Mi from The Sound of Music. So do stay tuned till the end. Fine, so you have B flat. What comes to B flat? It's dominant. So da F, B flat, G seventh, C minor, A seventh, D minor, not D major, D minor, because it's B flat major scale. Okay, B flat, E flat, E flat major, then C seventh, which is the five of the five, which is F, and then D seventh is the five of the six. That's pretty much it. In addition to your entire chord theory of the major scale, you need to also plot out your secondary dominant chords. And yeah, there are a few more things we plot out, like our chord extensions, our parallel chords. We'll get into that soon. So secondary dominance is the focus, because the song which I'm going to share with you, which is Do a Deer, a Female Deer, pretty much revolves entirely around secondary dominance. So now let's get started with analyzing Do a Deer and then applying what we learned using the theory of secondary dominance with the song, right? Of course, the song has been composed beautifully. Our goal is to just kind of analyze it and hopefully make similar music in the time to come, moving forward. Right, so let's now look at applying all that we've learned, all the secondary dominant theory and general chord theory inside this masterpiece of a song, Do a Deer from The Sound of Music. So we start with the tonic chord, Do a Deer, which is B flat major. Do a deer, a female deer, and here's the fun. Re, a drop of golden sun. So it kind of lets you hang in the balance. Re, a drop of golden sun. And if you observe what Julie Andrews is singing, she's actually singing on the chords. It's not a very linear melody. It's la da 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 da. She's always landing on one of those notes of that F major chord. She's kind of reiterating the harmony. So Do a Deer, a Female Deer. So if you look at the notes of that melody, Do a Deer, it's essentially singing on the B flat major triad. It's just that Do a Deer, all the non-important English words, Do a Deer. Is not an important word, isn't it? The word doe is obviously important because that's a female deer, and obviously the word deer will be important. So you kind of ignore words like of, I, to, all of those words, you know, which are not adjectives, just connecting words, right? So a songwriter, what they will do is generally not bother about landing on those notes, because it's annoying to even say it in free speech or in a poem. You never talk by highlighting a word like or off, isn't it? So what tends to happen is the songwriter will be doing all this activity together. They'll be composing the chords, probably having their pen and paper, their piano, everything ready, and singing the melody at the same time. So it all kind of comes together. So when the melody line is presented, it's just a way of highlighting the harmony. So if you think about it, the melody and the harmony are actually one in a song. It's not different and it's obvious. We hear both together at the same time, isn't it? And rhythm binds them together. So you'll have all the important words, doe, deer, and so on and so forth, at the strong beats of the bar. And the strong beat will be beat one, generally, and exactly where you'd want your chord to change, and also the notes or the melody points which are long. Okay, do a deer, see how fast she sings a. Do a deer, a female deer. So always these a's tend to just quickly move forward. So as a musician, when we take these not so important words like a and if and to and whatnot, we kind of look at it more creatively because the chord is defining most of what we compose as a melody. But at those points, at those not so important words, we can connect, we can do things outside the scale, or we can do notes which are at least outside the chord, like what's happening here. Do a deer, do a deer. So C connects to D. A female deer, a drop of golden sun. Right? So generally the vocalist is going to highlight, or the melody line is going to highlight the crucial chord tones, especially the 1, the 3, and maybe even the 7. And what will happen on the chord department is you play the chord and the vocal will kind of extend that chord and just make the chord come to life, so to speak. Moving on. So B flat, a deer, a female deer. F seventh, a drop of golden sun. And now me a name, I call myself. She uses the two other notes of the B flat major chord. Me a name, I call my, which is D and F. So very chordal melody. Then, far a long, long way to run. Now that's a beautiful extension there. So the vocalist is deciding to sing run, which is actually a ninth extended above the seventh. Far a long, long way to run. So that's where it's possible for the vocalist to add the color, you know. So now moving forward, we have the sew a needle pulling thread. Sew a needle pulling thread. Okay. So now the secondary dominant stuff starts happening. So a needle pulling thread. So where did I want to go at thread? E flat is the chord at thread. But what connects it? It's secondary dominant chord. So what is the fifth of E flat? B flat. So B flat wants to go to E flat. You can even do a B flat seventh to pull it even stronger. B flat, a B flat seventh going to E flat. Okay, and then we do another secondary dominant dual chord system. La, C seventh, a note to follow. So why did I do C seventh to F? F was my land, a landing chord, a stable chord. Its fifth is C. A note to follow, so, and C7th will make it really nice. And look at what the vocalist is doing in the lyrics. It's really pulling the chord further, right? It's further emphasizing how unstable the first chord is and how stable the second chord is. So a needle pulling thread. She's pretty much singing on the scale. So a B flat, C, D, E flat, F, G. The melody sort of glides itself to the next chord. So it's a really well composed song. Beautiful harmony, great melody, awesome lyrics, right? So get acquainted with it. And whenever you learn songs like this, which are great songs, as countless generations will tell us, you're learning a lot. And when you compose music, you should always try and compose it instinctively. You should never force the song. The song should kind of come to you. Okay, so the more concepts you learn, the more songs you digest and analyze, I guess it's better in the long run for you as a composer. Okay, so a needle pulling thread. So is a land, B flat, a needle pulling thread. Thread, she lands on G, which is part of the E flat chord, which is the next chord. She really highlights the two chords. So, la, a note to follow, so. See how she left the scale there, actually. La, Because it was the point of the matter was to go from C7 a note to follow, so she got that license to sing that E, even though it's not there in the B flat major scale. So the melody is gone off the scale, off the grid, because the chords are off the grid, you know. So la a note to follow, so moving on, the same story. T, which is D7th, a drink with jam and bread. That was the 5 of the 6. And then you do another secondary dominant, which is the 5 of the 4-5-1, which is a very common ending. So if we explore the last line, that will bring us back to do. Okay, so that's a very traditional ending in a lot of songs, where you do the 4 major, 5 major, and then the tonic. So it really emphasizes the tonic. The 4 is what we call as the subdominant or the predominant. 5 is the dominant, as we've seen. And then you end with the tonic. So let me just break this down once more by just doing the whole thing again. I'll try and name the chords for you as well as I play along. Okay. So what is the purpose of this video again? It's to basically explore this great song and look at how it really exploits the topic of secondary dominance, which you can find in a lot of music which may not be that popular or may not be that current, you know, it may not be written in 2021. You'll have to go back, rewind time, maybe to Elton John, Queen, Sting, Billy Joel. So these are the artists who really use secondary dominance well, with, and that's what makes them unique. And I guess their songs are great because they've been around for so long. They've been around for, some of them, you know, 50, 60 years. If you go back to some of the Beatles classics as well, right? So this song is no different, but I thought of taking this specific song because it just zeroes in on that one concept, secondary dominance. So I found a lot of students try to read this from textbooks and mug up the theory. I really think if you take an already existing song like this, which sort of teaches you secondary dominance, it's almost like education. Learning the song is the theory, you know. And by learning this, you'll get more naturally acquainted with the sound of secondary dominance. Okay, let's break this down again, and then we are pretty much done with the lesson. Do a dear, the tonic chord. Re, that's the dominant. That's 5. Back to the dominant results. Call myself dominant. Far a long, long way to run. That's a dominant. Goes back to the tonic, which is the 5 of 4, which is E flat. Now C7th out of the scale. Na na, which is the 5 of 5. And then you go to D7th, which is the 5 of 6. Then 5 of 4-0-5-1. And that's pretty much the song. So the last video showed you the melody line of the song. It showed you how to play it, how to get the correct fingering. It also showed you the bass notes and the root chords. This video, we kind of dived in a lot further with the theory behind the song, using secondary dominance and how it resolves and how it's a chord which is out of the scale, which comes back to the scale, right? So this is about our two-part series on exploration of Do Re Mi and secondary dominance all together, you know. And hopefully you can make some use of this concept and make some music using this concept. Again, this is Jason here from Nathaniel. If you haven't already, hit the subscribe button, turn on that bell, and anything else. You can like the video, share the video, leave us a comment for something you'd like to learn in the future. And also do consider following us on Patreon, where every single one of my lessons, whatever we do, every one of the notes and notation, everything has been handwritten and it's put there as a neat downloadable file. Cheers, and catch you in the next one.